Andrologopoulos, as you already know. I'm a professor, associate professor at the University of Thessaloniki. I will present a view about the semblances, which is quite close to what Dimitris was saying earlier, but I will start from a quite distant point, which is the point of design process, which is the main subject of my research. And also I will present some examples of the view that I'm going to present in a design studio. That's why I added to the title Assemblages in Practice, hoping that this will represent my view. So, design as a process got a lot of attention back on the 70s with a trend of design theories that were looking on designing as a linear process that starts from a brief, then an analysis of the data that had to do with this brief, a synthesis, a composition that produces something, a formal formation, and then a process of evaluation which evaluates this formation against the requirements that are initially are given by the brief. Well, this view was quite limited and was really initiated from a field of problem solving that appeared usually in the scientific domain. But nevertheless, a lot of schools have really accommodated this view. Still, a lot of schools of architecture give to the students in the studios an initial brief, and they ask them to respond to this brief by producing something that takes care about the requirements. However, I would like to develop a much broader sense of designing, and therefore I started looking at the fields of interest of design. And this is something that more or less describes these fields of interest in design: form, function, context, and material and structure. For those of you that are not architects, form has to do with the optical and spatial characteristics of the design object. It is mainly conditioned by geometry, topology, and rules that regulate its sounds, the soundness of the form playing an important role. Function, here it is used in its broader sense, every functionality that has to be achieved by the object. It has to do with its usefulness. It can relate to different fields of interest and can attain assessments with knowledge that can be explicitly defined. Context is the relation of the object with the natural, historical, social environment. Some of these relations can be assessed also through logical reasoning, but not as explicitly as function. And material structure is obviously everything that has to do with the construction of the object. So how well, the design is something that is in the middle of all this, if we see this diagram again, and is realized as an effort to provide the fit of all the requirements, the discontinuities, the disorders, the conflicts that appear within these different fields. But how can we map this activity, this effort? I think that a good example of the transformations that the design undergoes within this design activity is this theory by Robin Evans back from the 1995. Robin Evans was a great historian and theorist in the Architectural School of Architectural Association in London. And the main principle of his theory was that design progresses through the different transformations that the representations of design undergo when the information is moving from the one expression to the other expression. So eventually, through an effort of continuous clarification of the description of the design object, these transformations from the different representational media provide a clearer account of the design object. However, Evans didn't really talk about computers at all, even though computers were already in the field of architecture, both in the school and the practice. And also, he didn't tell a lot about how the relations between the different fields of information that I described earlier appear on the drawings. So I propose this kind of map of this design activity, in which the central part of the design activity is a dynamic model. The dynamic model is related to the expressions, to the representations that Robin Evans was talking about, but the dynamic model is in the computer, it's a digital model. It is constituted by geometric entities, but it accepts a lot of assessments and a lot of decompositions through syntactic rules and grammatical rules. And also, towards this side, these are all the different discrete knowledge bases that have to do with the functionalities that the design object has to achieve. They have to do with different aspects, like, for example, distribution, circulation, energy performance, etc. And here we have these knowledge bases, knowledge domains usually can be explicitly defined, and you can have rational reasoning to act upon this this assessment, this knowledge. And here we have form and structure, which has to do with knowledge that, for example, comes from theories of aesthetics, perceptual knowledge, tactile knowledge, and all this stuff, which can affect the dynamic model, but it's not so clearly defined, it cannot get logical reasoning. Still, this view doesn't talk a lot about the situation within which the design activity is realized. So, in order to somehow capture both this situation, the conditions of the design, and also the presence of a designer who acts upon the information, came up to this sort of representation, this model of design, in which above these different fields that affect the dynamic model is fiction, where fiction is all everything that the designer brings to the design discourse through his personality, through his experience, his or her experience, his or her idiosyncrasies, his style, etc. And this shows the different kinds of knowledge that affect the three main areas that affect design. So through this sort of mapping, a new reformulation of all the information that appears in the design course happens, and different instances of information appear to be more important than others, and a focus is given to different relations according to the design intentions that appear, that arise through the designer's responsibility to act upon information. I think that this kind of mapping is the assemblage of the design discourse, is something that takes care about the point of view of the designer, well, actually somehow expresses this point of view, and also is a very responsive and dynamic map of relations within the design discourse. Of course, this scheme here, this form is really indicative, but it simply implies that there is some structure, there is some form that can provide a path for the design. So, the assemblage of the design discourse has a lot of properties that already discussed within this room. It is consistent, even though operating on several unrelated pieces of information or discrete models. It is individual, as it initiates from the designer's personal intentions. This obviously has to do with all this idea of the design that we already discussed. It is irreducible and indecomposable. It points out possible direction and justifies design decisions. It may not rely on logical reasoning, but it provides a path for the design process. It takes into account the purpose of the design. This is quite important also. It is dynamic, as it is based on the designer's responsibility to act upon information, and it's generative. The design emerges as a space of possibilities that arises through the overall connectivity and the assemblage capacity to interact. So, as a next step, I tried to bring this view to the design studio. Some years ago, we started together with Dimitris and some other people, a studio in the design of the Architectural School of Thessaloniki, where we wanted to give to the students, first of all, to ask them to develop this their personal view on something, the condition, a special concept, a narrative. And in order to do this, we didn't really want to give them a brief. So instead of giving them a brief, we actually provide them with this a notion or this concept, and we were asking them to try to understand this, to comprehend this notion, this concept, or this dipole of some concepts, and then to give, to provide a diagram, a dynamic diagram that somehow represents, expresses their understanding of this concept. I will show you some of the examples. Like, for example, here is a diagram of a collision, a crash, because something that is moving and something happens and is crashed. This is more special. It is, well, doesn't show very well, but there is a diagram of a melting surface. These are diagrams of the notion of diffusion, and these were initially done as an experiment through some surfaces, material, etc., and then eventually they became dynamic diagrams which could also take other properties. So this diagram then was moved to the computer, and initially, will eventually get enriched with constraints from functionality, context, and all of this different information that we were discussing earlier. I will show you two projects in a bit more detail to somehow illustrate this view on design process. The first one, both of these projects are diploma projects, are from students that participated in the design studio but then explored it a bit further. So the first one starts from the idea of porosity, both as a physical property and also as a condition. And the design starts with some models, initially from made from wax, and then by gypsum, that first explored this condition of porosity. Unfortunately, the pictures are not shown very well, but nevertheless, this is a cut of the model. And then this model starts to get functional properties, like for example, or structural properties, like for example here, the bigger the model, the bubbles of the within the model are on the higher part of the model, allow us big mass to concentrate on the lower part, so that in this way a structure that can bear loads from the above can be attained. In this case, the connection of the bubbles on the top can bring light and air within the model, like in this case, for example. And eventually, a design intention is developed to use this model as a model of an underground metro station. So, further development occurs, like for example here, distribution, programmatic elements, and when the model goes into the computer, it uses this dynamic geometric entity of metaballs. Metaballs are parametric spheres that have the tendency to become bigger when they are attracted to each other. Or you can really provide different sort of proximity parameters, and so that when they are attracted, they get connected. When they are repelled, they have to move away. These are used in order to model different distribution groups and programmatic elements within the metro station, like for example to all the public space to get together. Here you almost can see some images from the contextual aspects, like for example the entrance to the metro station, and here you can see some of the final results, like for example here the plan at the level of the platform of the metro station, and here is a section. The next example starts from the reading of a book. This is a well-known book by Franz Kafka, Der Bau, in English the building. And if you know the book is about a relation between a human and a building. And during the story, the building somehow starts to interact with the human emotions and responds to his needs and responds to his thinking as being something like a living thing. So the students start to develop this diagram through the reading of the book. So this is the diagram of the assemblers. And then they have this intention to design a building that is also acts like this, like a living organism. So they start looking at structures that can have different properties in relation to different parameters. This is, for example, a structure of weaving, which gets difficult different properties in relation to the density of the weaving. And also the material, this is bioplastics material, which is a substance that comes from starch, either from corn or potatoes, and looks like rubber when it's processed with sugar water, and they look at it as something that also can have a certain lifespan in the sense that they develop, they try to find the process of photocatalysis which disintegrates this material. And they start looking at, unfortunately the slides are very bad, but anyway, the development of the structure, obviously the reference to plants and trees is pretty obvious here. Syntactic rules of how the different branches of the structure are connected. The articulation and the structural optimization of the structure. So in this case, every part of the different structure is tested and simulated through structural engineering programs to see how it can support some loads. The differentiation in partitioning, how dense the structure is and how can allow different views and different space continuities within it. And some of the properties and the scale of it. And this shows the material decay, how it is initial and how it becomes disintegrated through the photocatalysis process. And the idea is to develop something that lives together with its inhabitants in the sense that it responds to its needs and when nobody lives within this building, the building simply decays and dies. This diagram shows the whole process, starting from the initial diagrams to the structure, to the material, the growth of it, the decay, and finally its death. So this is an image of the final sort of outcome. So this studio has stopped some years ago, but we actually have moved to all this view of experimental architecture to the next level, and we started this postgraduate program that Dimitris already has talked about, where the idea of the assemblers, the idea of the after machine is quite central, among other ideas. But in order to conclude for this short presentation, I will just say that assemblers in design do not foresee a process aiming to produce a single optimum solution. They retain associations to contextual and functional constraints from internal and external factors and parameters, which are structured through the regulation of a strong narrative or concept. They suggest an evolutionary design activity that is directed towards a formal resolution as a fit between design information and the designer's individual intentions through cross-level evaluations. And this process is a highly responsive process in which the design emerges in a bottom-up fashion through the overall connectivity of information and the transformative interactions of assemblages within it. So, thank you very much.